family, if there's anyone that needs a prayer, you're welcome to make your way to the front so that the leaders can pray with you as we continue to worship.
Some say just a wooden cross, but I can see the grace of your redemptive heart. Some say this is foolishness, but I believe the truth of your redeeming love. Some will say this place belongs to history, but I can see, yes, I can see, a cross that changes everything.
see is perfect through your Son. On the cross is where my heart was won. I have victory because you overcame. My Jesus died and rose again.
Just lift your hands this morning.
It was for freedom.
Declare it.
That I am forgiven.
Hallelujah. Oh, come on, let's give the Lord a praise and a shout this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Just lift your hands for one moment. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus. This morning, it's all about you. Every single Sunday, it's all about you. We give our first fruit unto you. Thank you, Jesus, that we gather for your celebration. Thank you, Jesus, that it's all about you and get people saved for you. Thank you, Jesus, for every person in this place. I pray this morning that ears will be open, eyes will see, hearts will perceive, Lord Jesus, the exceedingly abundantly favor that you have on our lives, Lord Jesus. And Father, I thank you that this word this morning will go deep. And it is the incorruptible seed of the word of God, Lord Jesus, that will produce the fruit of the Spirit, but also the fruit in our gifts and also the fruit in our lives, Lord Jesus, that we need to see. And Father, I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you open up ways and places that seems to be cluttered. Thank you, Father, that Holy Spirit, you are the teacher, that you will teach us this morning, and that we will experience the goodness through this message right now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, come on, give somebody a high five. Say welcome to CRC, the place to be. It's great to have you with us. All the first-time visitors, if you would be so kind to just quickly wave. All the first-time visitors, just wave, wave, wave. We want to welcome you. It is great to have you with us. Come on, let's give them a welcome. Hallelujah. Well, I want to jump straight into the word. So let me first just greet everybody that needs to be greeted this morning. It's great to be with you this morning, all the way from the prison, male, female, and the juveniles. Always good to be with you this morning, straight right in the prison. Thank God for technology. Okay. Even some of you, when you go on holiday, I would like to see your messages that you say, Pastor, I've been on holiday, but still I watch you on live stream. Come on. Come on, that's why we have the technology for you available. Amen. Amen. Well, I've been busy now with this series about the cross, the power of the cross, and we are going into Easter weekend. Don't forget, Friday, we have our Easter service, Good Friday service, 9:30 Friday morning. So this is an opportunity for you to invite people, because some people only come to church on Easter and on Christmas. So use the opportunity, okay? I said this morning to the ushers, it's funny how our cultures work. When people go on holiday or when it's holiday time, you will find all the white people will go away, and you will find all the black people will go home, and you will find all the brown people, the colored people, they will clean home. They'll stay home. Okay? It's true. How many of you can agree with me? It's true. Okay, so this is an opportunity. I know that usually it's conference time. Okay, in our colored community this time of the year. So bring people to the conference, man. Come on. Let's make a conference out of this weekend. Why not? Three services, Friday morning, Sunday morning, and Sunday evening. Okay, we have a special play also on Sunday evening with CRC Creative Arts. They are producing a beautiful, beautiful production. So don't miss Sunday night. Invite people to come and see and to experience that. And as well, and I think we are in for a good surprise tonight also, because I see Pastor Charles Nieman, one of my heroes, and Pastor Ad's advisory people on his advisory board, is actually preaching this morning in Pretoria. So I believe he will be most probably preaching tonight as well. I mean, Pastor Ad will have him for all the churches. So don't miss tonight, because that man really changed my life through one sermon that he preached about renewing your mind. So make sure that you don't miss tonight. Make sure that you are here, so that you can receive a phenomenal, phenomenal service. I'm telling you, he's one of those irons that God has created for us in this generation, for us to listen to, that will have a phenomenal impact on our lives. Amen. Are you ready this morning for the word? The power of the cross, okay? As I said last week, I am busy with the teaching. This is not the jump and hallelujah, even though you can jump and shout hallelujah, everything is fine. But the thing is, this is more of thinking, so that it can sink deep, go from logos to rhema, okay? So that it's not just in your head, but in your heart and understanding. So I'm going to recap a little bit about what I've started on last week, because I haven't finished. And I'm taking it little by little, line upon line, precept upon precept, so that people can grasp the importance of this message. Because once you understand the power of the cross, my friend, you will never miss one church service ever again in your life. It's only people who understand what the cross has done that will cause them never to miss a church service ever again. Because you see, in religion, we are taught you must go. But once you understand the cross, then you realize that your whole lifeline is all dependent upon the word of Jesus Christ. And whenever you get an opportunity to hear the word or attend the service, you are there. And that's why you get people that go to church and they get bored with church. Why? Because they don't understand the revelation of what the cross has done in the timeline of humanity and also in the timeline of your life. Because once you understand the impact that it has on your life, you can't miss one service. You can't miss one gathering. You will be there always. So it's a revelation. And this is what I want to get to, is the revelation for you not just to think about, but to get into your heart. Amen. All right, so let's go Today, I'm continuing with part two. The cross changes everything. We sing that song. There's a reason why we're singing it, because we need to understand the power of the cross and that it really changed everything. Not just some things, but everything. It changed everything. Amen. Say everything. Hallelujah. So let's go straight in the word. John chapter 19, verse 30. John chapter 19, verse 30, the Bible says, "And when he had tasted the wine, he said, 'It is finished,' and he bowed his head and he died." This is the defining moment of Christianity. This is the defining moment of what happened in the Bible. This is what separates the Old Testament from the New Testament. This is where the Old Covenant passed away and the New Covenant began. It's when Jesus, at this moment, when he was hanging on the cross, and he said, "It is finished." Now, as I said last week, he didn't say, "I am finished." He said, "It is finished." Okay? Because he still had a lot to do, and he still have a lot to do. Okay, Jesus never stops. But he says, "It is finished." Now the question is, what is the "it"? And we discovered through a few scriptures that we read that "it" is the law. The law and the Old Testament. Okay? You see, if you know you're gonna die someday, then you write a testament. Okay? You write a beautiful testament that will be laid to your children. Okay? So when your children one day, when you die, they go to the lawyers, and then everything will be divided according to the testament. Okay? So what happens now is suddenly Jesus comes and he says, the Old Testament was all about, if you can keep the law, you will receive righteousness. If you cannot keep the law, you will be unrighteous and you will be doomed for hell for eternity. That is the Old Testament in a nutshell. Everything about the Old Testament is that you will die if you cannot fulfill the righteousness of God. So everything in the Old Testament became a work towards righteousness. I have to become righteous by doing the right things. So God gives the Ten Commandments, and the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. And then he says, if you miss one letter, if you will miss one of these ideas, if you miss one of them, it means you have missed the whole thing. So you can fulfill 9 out of 10. That doesn't mean you have a pass rate of 90%. It means you fail with 10%, which means you fail the whole test. It's almost like playing video games or computer games with the kids. It's one thing that I hated the most about playing computer games. That's why I don't like this stuff. Okay? Because you would get all the way almost to the end of that section or that part, and you almost get there, and it's like, and then suddenly your little man dies or something, so you have to start the whole thing over again. Okay, now I hate that. I don't want to, when I miss it, yeah, start all over again. No, please just drop me there where I died and give me another chance and let's go. Okay, that's how I like it. So I hate it to play video games and you always have to start at level 1 again, level 2, and you go through. So I just stop playing the whole thing because it really irritates me. I can't waste time like that. Okay? So, but this is exactly what the law did. If you missed number 9, you're back to square 1. You have to start all over again. And it's again, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. When you get to number 9 and you miss it again, you start all over again. And it's like in the Old Testament, the Pharisees and the Sadducees kind of played this game until they perfected it. But the perfection in the game was not the fact that they actually applied and behaved according to it, but they actually just found loopholes. Okay, so they came to Jesus. They said, "Jesus, Moses gave us a bill of divorce. What do you say?" Jesus says, "It's because of the hardness of your hearts. You found a loophole." So he realized you're going to destroy one another. So he gave you a bill of divorce, but I say thou shalt not divorce. Okay, so he gives these instructions. So. People will always, when there is a law, find a way around the law. If there's a contract, they will find a loophole in the contract. Always just not to be accountable, not to be held accountable. That's what people want to do. They will always try to find a place where they should not stay faithful for the rest of the time. There's always a back door. There's always a way out. This is people. Now, as I said last week, when Jesus lived, Jesus, and quickly throw up that on the screen, please. As I said, you look at the power of the cross, you see the cross, the timeline, BC, AD, before Christ, as we say as Christians, and after Christ, because Jesus died when he breathed out his breath, it was the year zero. So he was born before the year zero, and he died the day zero. That's amazing, isn't it? It's already a whole sermon in itself. But the fact is, if you look at that line, just look at the left. It says Jesus was born and he lived. He lived Mark, Luke, John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, obviously. Okay? See, they mixed it up a bit. Hulle moet gaan kyk hoe julle Bybels geskryf is. Dis Matteus, Markus, Lukas, Johannes. Nie andersom. Okay? So, the fact is, the four Gospels are before the cross. It's before the New Testament began. You see, this is where most people miss it. They think when Jesus walked the earth, he was already in the New Testament. He was already in the New Covenant. No, he wasn't. Jesus was still ministering under the law. He was still ministering under the law. You need to get it. Listen what Jesus said. Okay, let's continue. He says, Matthew chapters 5 to 17 and 17 to 20, it says, "Do not think that I have come to destroy the law and the prophets, but I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or title will by no means pass away until all is fulfilled. Whosoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men to do so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever does and teach them, he will be called the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that unless your righteousness," that's the key, "exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven." Okay? So what does Jesus say? Jesus says, it is now time where I have come to fulfill things, but it's not fulfilled yet. He says, I have come to preach the kingdom of God. I have come to restore the kingdom. Because before Adam and Eve sinned, it was the full kingdom. And then they sinned, and then what happened? Sacrifice had to be made in order for you to be righteous. You had to fulfill the law. You had to do in order to be. So it's kind of in the Old Testament that human beings wasn't human beings, they were human doings. They had to do and do and do in order to be justified. So you have to kill the lamb and pour the blood on the mercy seat so that you can be saved. And then next year you had to do the same thing. So you only had once a year where you were actually sinless. And then if you woke up again and you'd sinned again, then you would be doomed for hell. Because the wages of sin is death. Death means eternal separation from God. What is hell? Hell is the only place that God can give you where he's not. Listen how I say it. Hell is the only place that God can give you where he is not. Because hell is a reward for those who don't want God. Wow, how can you say that? Hell, it's in such a terrible place. How is it a reward? Because the only place where God doesn't exist, where he is not, is hell. Eternal separation from God. Okay? And when we say we don't want Jesus, what do we say? We basically say, well, I don't want Jesus, so where do I end up? In a place where I will never see Jesus again. So it's a reward of my desire. That's why he says he will give you the desire of your heart. Just another angle, right? It's a bit different to look at it that way. Because we think hell is punishment. It's not. Punishment was sin on the cross. Jesus punished sin on the cross through Jesus Christ. He became sin who knew no sin so that we may become the righteousness of God in Christ. So the punishment was on the cross 2,000 years ago. It was already punished. God ain't mad anymore. He was mad one day. If you don't believe me, the Bible says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to open blind eyes, to set free those who are captive. And then he says, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of God's vengeance. There was only one day of God's vengeance. One day of God's vengeance, and that was upon the cross of Jesus Christ. That was the day, day zero. Amen? So God ain't mad at people. He loves people. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe on him, the cross and the finished work of the cross, shall not perish but have everlasting life. Life everlasting. I say to people, come on guys, we are living in this world and now you're looking at everything that's happening in the country and you're listening and you're watching Facebook and you watch this and everybody gets so negative. And then you share all this nonsense of racism and this thing and that thing. The world is full of sin. Why do you want to share sin on the Facebook? What do you expect a sinner to do? Oh, look at this guy. He just beat this one. What do you expect him to do? He's lost. It's like expecting a dog not to bark. The dog has been barking. Now he's sharing it on Facebook. The dog barks. Yeah, really, the dog barks. That's what the dog does. So what do you expect? You expect that there will be sin. So why do you keep on sharing sin? We talk about God. Let these things, which are pure, holy, and acceptable on the Lord, let dwell upon these things, the Bible says. Think about these things. So what do I think? Because it quickly comes out of my mouth and on my Facebook, right? And as the young people said to me, Facebook is phone means, it's on Instagram. Okay? But you hear what I'm saying? So be careful. We are in the finished work of the cross, and we need to believe in what God has done in the cross through Jesus Christ. We are in a sinful world with sinners. Okay? You need to understand that. Okay, so what do you what happens here? Jesus comes and he says to the disciples, he teaches them, he trains them, he teaches people, he tells them, he says, but it's not fulfilled yet. You will still have to comply by the law, because the law is a teacher. The law will teach you what you have been saved from. So this law is there because you need to know that God is holy. Okay? And the only way that you will find God to be holy is when his excellence level is just so much higher. And when his rules are so much higher. When his laws in his house are so much higher. You walk into a man's house and according to the rules of the house, you will determine in how much excellence they live. You walk into God's kingdom and his rules are so high that nobody can meet them. And you realize, my goodness, he's got such high standards. His high standards are so high. His standards are so high. And not just expecting to be good, but only to be good. What am I saying? You walk the earth and then Jesus comes and he tells people, he says, well, so what does the Ten Commandments say? One says, well, the Ten Commandments says, you must love the Lord your God. And Jesus says, you must love the Lord your God with all your mind, all your heart, all your strength. So he makes it impossible. Because honestly, people will walk around and they will say, well, I love the Lord with all my heart. Really? But you love your husband, you love your wife, you love your dog, you love knickknacks. I love, I love, I love. You're so generous with the love of your heart to everything else, which means you don't really love God with all your heart. Because if it was with all your heart, it will only be God. Are you with me? So it's not to put law on people to say, well, you bad old filthy sinner, you bad old worm. There's nothing good about you. No, it is to bring you to a place where you realize who can be saved. There is no good thing that dwelleth within me. Because if I don't have Jesus, I'm lost. And when Jesus came, he just raised the bar. He made it much higher. He made it higher and higher. He said, okay, so you say. They said, well, the bill of, after the whole thing about the bill of divorces, Jesus says, okay, but you say in your law. He says, if you commit adultery, you are in danger of hellfire. I say, if a man look at a woman thinking, there he just disqualified all humans, all men. In one moment. Some of you women are so shocked when I say that. It's like, really? And when you get home and you fight with your husband, love it, you really look at other women. Jesus, help me, I don't. And it's not that he's looking at other women. It's nature. Fallen sin nature. Suddenly this woman, and sometimes the poor man, he doesn't even mean to look at the woman, but then she's wearing such lo and behold dresses and so up and tight that the poor man the next moment is like, woo. And that's usually when the woman next to him starts, the claws are coming out. like that, I just say, honey, go get him. Amen. But you listen, are you listening to what I'm saying? Because the problem is, people, I'm dealing with real life here. I'm not just trying to make good behaving Christians. Really, we're building a church here. So it's not about just gathering a crowd. Sometimes people say, oh, it's a big crowd, oh, it's a small crowd, oh, this, oh, that. What the heck? It doesn't matter. The thing is, it's building people because we're building the church. We can all be having good behavior because this is the problem in our world. Our world has taught people to behave well. So if you behave well, you're accepted. If you behave bad, then you're unaccepted. So you will have a lot of well-behaving, dirty, old, filthy sinners whose hearts are rotten, but they behave well. Oh, we see that often on a Sunday. Dressed up, beautiful, beautiful face. All, everything is good, but nobody knows. And that's why Jesus looked at these Pharisees and Sadducees. He said to them, you are brood of vipers. You clean the outside of the cup, but the inside is filthy bad. You're full of dead men's bones. Because God does not look at the outside appearance. He looks on the heart. Where is your heart? So you can have well-behaving Christians, but you have well-behaving Christians whose hearts are not with God. You can go through all the motions. You can go to church. You can read your Bible. You can pray. You can be one of the greatest. You can quote all the scriptures in the Bible, and you can pray the most beautiful prayer. However, your heart is far from God. And it's only you that know, and Him. And this is why we cannot go on with this whole behavioral changes to make people acceptable, because it has not worked for the church. The church has done it for many years, where they change people's behavior, but the hearts doesn't change. That's why we don't do altar calls in church anymore. How can you have a church and not do an altar call? Because we are teaching people to behave well, but yet we never give them opportunity to give their lives to Jesus. A surrendered heart, a born-again heart. But we applaud behavior. Are you with me this morning? You see where I'm going? So we are just at the same place where Jesus was when he arrived on the planet Earth. He says, oh, you people, for 400 years you have perfected this. Pharisees, Sadducees, you have perfected this art of getting out of it because your behavior is good. Your behavior. That's why the one Pharisee could stood up and say, Lord, thank you that I'm not like that sinner. And that's why Jesus used it as an example. So now you are there and everybody applauds you, but in heaven, nobody knows your name. Oh, I'll live for the applause of one person. I don't need everybody's applause. I need Jesus' applause. I need Jesus to say, go my son, well done, you are doing great. I'm so proud of you. Instead of everybody, ooh, look at him, he's so great, but yet my heart doesn't belong to Jesus. What does it help you to gain the approval of the whole world, but yet you lose your own soul? That's why you cannot be in the ministry for popularity's sake. Because you will, for 10 years, 20 years, 50 years maybe, and then it's over. And then what's left? So we need to come back to this whole reality of what is the cross of Jesus Christ. Not what is sin, because sin has been dealt with. That's why many people get mad and say, you must preach more sin. You must meet. No, sin has been dealt with. I don't need to preach sin. The Bible says, listen, the Bible says the Holy Spirit will convict you of sin, of righteousness and judgment. Not me. It's not the Christian's job to look at a person and make them feel bad about their sin. Oh, I thought I'm going to get a better hallelujah than that. It's not the Christian's job. It's not the Christian's job to try to prove to people why they are sinners. The Bible says it is the Holy Spirit. You're not the Holy Spirit. When last did you check in the mirror? You're not Him. You carry the Holy Spirit, but that doesn't mean you telling people you're a sinner. When you walk in, you should be full of so much love and goodness that the sinner will feel convicted. You think, man, I want to be like him. I want to be like her. But there's some Christians, when they walk in the room, you just start to duck. Just don't say anything because you're going to kill me with your words. Really? So, honestly, you are have these two extremes. Are you with me this morning? I'm trying to get somewhere. And I need you to come with me because we have all these concepts and it's people are so stuck in this thing. And I want to get people out of this thing of trying to work towards my righteousness and having everybody else to work towards their righteousness. The problem about this is if you're going to keep on trying to work towards your righteousness and eventually you find a place where you think you are behaving well enough, somebody will say something to burst your bubble and you will end up way back where you were before you gave your life to Jesus. The rich young ruler came to Jesus. He said to Jesus, what must I do to follow you? What must I do to follow you? What must I do? What did the Pharisee say? Nicodemus, what did he say to Jesus? What must I do? What must I do to be a Christian? What must I do? There's nothing you can do. Because everything you do is sin. So what must I do? Just come to Jesus. Allow him to be Jesus. Allow him to be Savior. Allow him to be the one that redeems you. Allow him to be the loving God, the Father that will pick you up and clean you up. Jonathan doesn't come to me and say, Papa, I'm going to bath now. And then he jumps in the bath and he gets out a clean baby. No, he plays in the mud. If I get him out of the mud, he shouts and screams. And then I put him in the bath water and now he starts playing. He enjoys it. And then he gets clean and afterwards he feels clean and fresh. And this is how God loves people. You got to stop sinning. You got to get yourself out of your sin. You better get... What's that? I'm sorry. Maybe I just burst some of your bubbles because that's the only ministry that you know. Your ministry is to be like God. God is good. You know when Oral Roberts started preaching early years, that was the one thing that he started declaring. He had one statement. Every time he got on the stage, and some of you don't even know who I'm talking about. He's one of the great generals, fathers of faith, of the history in the early 1900s. And he stood up and he would make this one declaration. He would say, God is good. And then people will start to throw in with tomatoes and rotten eggs. Because how can you say God is good? Now, when I say God is good, everybody's like, hallelujah. Amen. But when he said it, they threw him. Why? Because people believe that God is a judge. God is mad. God is angry. God wants to get you. God has got a whip. He's going to crack his whip on you. He's going to kill you. Because you dirty old filthy sinner. You were the reason why Jesus had the spikes in his hands. One of those thorns that stuck in his head was one of your sins. That's how people used to preach. Turn or burn, baby. That's what people used to do. Now suddenly it's the goodness of God that comes through. God is a good God. Amen? God is good. God loves you. It's the goodness of God that leads a man to repentance. So Jesus lives in the Old Testament. He's coming to the place where he will fulfill the law through dying and taking the punishment. Because that is the wages of sin is death. For you to fulfill the law, you've got to die. I'm going to say it again. For you to fulfill the Ten Commandments, you've got to die. Now, you don't hear what I'm saying. If you want to fulfill the Ten Commandments, you have to die. Otherwise, it's impossible to fulfill it. And still people live. Thou shalt not, 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 thou shalt, thou shalt, thou shalt, thou shalt not. It's quiet in this place. Maybe you're thinking now. Because our work is not to be right with God. Because whatever you do to be right with God, you're not good enough. That's why people still have this thing about trying to be good enough to one another. What is the biggest argument you will find in a household with a husband and a wife? They will always say, but you don't think I'm good enough. I'm not a good enough mommy. I'm not a good enough dad. I'm not good enough for the job. I'm not good enough to run my own business. I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough. I have to try harder. I have to work harder. Now I stress. Now I get sick. So what happens? I end up in a place where I'm not good enough. Exactly what I've been living my whole life. I can't do anything anymore. So what is happening? I'm poisoning myself by trying to be righteous. That's called self-righteousness. 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 When I speak to the guys in the prison, I ask them one question. So what have you done wrong? And you get one of two replies, always, just one of two. So the one will say, well, I have committed murder. That's the person that takes the responsibility. And then you will have the other one that says, well, they say I killed this man. They say I raped this one. They say I stole. They say. Adam and Eve, what have you done, Adam? Well, it wasn't me. It's this woman that you gave me, God. Eve, what are you doing? It's not me. It's the snake. The biggest old sickness of humankind. And all God says is just take responsibility for what you've done. If you put your finger in the cookie jar, yes, I did. Okay, so thank you. Now let's deal with it. You're not going to cut off your finger. Let's have grace. Just don't put your finger there again. Goodness. And then those who cannot receive forgiveness, then they're like, no, you've got to cut off his finger to teach him a lesson. Okay, you come first. It was your idea. As if you did nothing wrong. The men brought the woman in front of Jesus. Once again, the Bible says that if you are caught in the act of adultery, you will be stoned to death. Stoned to death. So they caught the woman in the act. But yet, when Jesus stood there, they only brought the woman. So where in this whole law did they get a loophole to get the man excluded and just the woman to be condemned? Once again, that's what humans do. They find a loophole. So the woman must pay. Because you see, the lineage comes through the woman in the Jewish nation, not through the man. It's different with us. It's usually through the man. But through the Jews, it was through the woman. Okay? So here comes this woman, and they throw her at Jesus' feet, and Jesus look at her, and they say, the law says we have to kill her. And Jesus is like, okay. And he bows down. I don't know what he wrote. Maybe one of the Ten Commandments. Okay? So he's down there with her. And then they say, so what do you say? Jesus gets up on their level, looks them in the eyes, and he says, he who has no sin casts the first stone. So what does Jesus do? He says, okay, so you want to kill her for one sin. Okay, let me kill you all for having sin. Just raise the bar. None of them can get over it, so what do? Drop their rocks and they leave. Now nobody's left. Jesus is righteous. He can kill her. And they look on her, go back down to her level. And he looks her in the eyes and he says, woman, where are your accusers? They're gone. Neither do I accuse you. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. The cross changes everything. Jesus comes and he raises the bar to such a high standard that when his disciples look at him, they say, it is impossible to be saved. When he said to the rich young ruler, you must fulfill the whole law. He fulfilled the whole law. And then Jesus looked at him and he saw that instead of the rich young man being a rich young man, he saw that the riches have the man. So he looked at the man and he says, one thing you lack, sell all you have, give to the poor and follow me. Jesus never said he has to give everything to the poor. He just said, give to the poor. So he said, just sell it, give to the poor and follow me. And suddenly it's too much for the man. It's like, no. And then all the disciples start murmuring around one another and they look at Jesus. They say, is it possible for anyone to be saved then? So once again, Jesus raised the bar so high so that he shows everybody there is no way in you, in yourself, in your flesh, that you will ever reach a place where God will say, well done, I'm proud of you. There's no way, not in yourself. He who comes to believe that Christ is the Savior, he who confesses Jesus Christ as the Lord and the Savior, he who says, I need Jesus, he is the one that shall be saved. My friend, when we look at the Old Testament, the New Testament, and we look at the life, our world, before Christ, after Christ, year zero, and we look at your life, you also have to have a cross in your life, in your lifetime. Jacques was born on the 13th of November 1981, and then he started living. And then on the 14th of April, 1996, he came to year zero. Before Christ and after Christ. And now it's at Christ, where I stood and I surrendered my life and I gave my life to Jesus Christ and I confessed him as my Lord and my Savior, where I realized that there is no way for me to live without Jesus. Even though I was raised with Jesus, even though I knew everything about Jesus, even though I went to church on Sundays, even though I even prayed for people in the name of Jesus, but I never had the revelation until I gave my life to Jesus. The day I was born again, a brand new baby, all things has passed away. Behold, all things has become brand new. My life started. My life started on the 14th of April, 1996. That's why I can have a physical birthday of the day that I was born, but there's nothing as powerful as my upcoming birthday, which is on the 14th of April. Because I celebrate my 14th of April birthday much more than what I do my physical birth. Because I lived a shadow until I met Jesus. If you'd never met Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, if the cross never entered your life, then it means you are still living a shadow. Many people tell me, but Pastor, I don't have a date and a time. Well, then, So you don't know when you started living. Then most probably you're still dead. Yeah, but Pastor, came a time. Well, my friend, get a time and a date, because it's extremely important. Well, but I grew up as a Christian. No, where's your date of birth? You've got a date of physical birth, have a date of rebirth. And some people say, what can I want? I thought I was saved. Yes, maybe, but are you? And then if you don't know and you're really in perplexed now, then ask Jesus, he will take you back to that day. Because my friends, if you grew up religiously thinking you're a Christian, then you will never recall an encounter with Christ. But if you gave your life to Jesus, you have an encounter, like Paul on his way to Damascus. Bam, he met Jesus and his life changed. Otherwise you live well-behaving, good-raised Christian, and I know Jesus, and Jesus is good to me. Everybody in the Old Testament also knew the Messiah, they also knew God, but they never encountered him. Because when the cross came, it became personal. It became Jesus face to face with you. It's not just through the church and through Christians and through my parents and through. Are you with me? It is at a place where you meet Jesus face to face. This is Jesus. He touches you. He changes you. Everything on the inside changes. Because spiritually he changes you. So if you don't have a cross in your life, an encounter with the cross, if Jesus never crossed your path, then you are still living without the cross, which means you still have to fulfill the Ten Commandments. That's why I said, what do you expect a sinner to do? To sin. But if I can take you back to your meeting with Jesus, that's where it changed. So what Satan will try to do is he will try to take you back under the law. That's why you have all the religions that want to take you back under the law. Suddenly they come and they say, but you've got to honor this feast and you've got to honor that feast. My friend, I've got a scripture in the Bible for you where Paul said, what is this thing with you guys that you want to go back now and fulfill all the different feasts? He says, hasn't Christ redeemed us from all these things? Hasn't he fulfilled it? So people will come to you and suddenly bring you under law again. And then they will tell you, but Sunday is the first day of the week, and so Saturday is actually the seventh day, which is true. I don't know why the Christians changed it and said this is Sunday is the seventh day, because it's not. Okay? It's the first day of the week. The seventh day of the week is Saturday. So what is this, the old Sabbath? The old Sabbath is from Friday night till Saturday night. Okay? So that's the Sabbath. But we are not honoring the Sabbath, because he's the Sabbath. Sondag is die Sabbatdag. Nee, dis nie. Hoef jouself lief nie, man. Hoe kan die winkels oop wees op 'n Sondag? Now maybe I'm hitting somewhere and it's making you uncomfortable. The fact is, it is up to you and your personal encounter with Jesus that will say, I will shut down my shop on a Sunday, because as a Christian, the first day of the week is more important to me. Why? Because the Bible says, bring your first fruit unto the Lord. So I will shut my shop on a Sunday, because Sunday is Jesus' day. So Sunday, you will find me in church and nowhere else. I said nowhere else. In the morning and in the evening. Nowhere else. Because this is Jesus's. Why? Because we celebrate Jesus. Are you with me? So some of you, yes, great, please shut your shop on a Sunday and be an outspoken Christian. And say, well, sorry, Sunday is Jesus's. I'm not going to allow anybody to be in the shop. I'm going to shut the shop. I'm going to go and let everybody be with Jesus. Because Jesus is number one in our life. His relationship is number one. His church is number one. Our relationship with his church is number one. So we will be in church on a Sunday. We're not going to be at the shop. Thank you. If you are unsaved or you're a Muslim or whatever else, you're welcome to keep my shop and running it. But I'm going to church. But then also, why do you want that in partnership with you? Because it's unequally yoked. So as a Christian, be outspoken about it, but then don't come to the law again and say, well, it's the Sabbath, and the Sabbath needs to be honored, and the Sabbath, this. Jesus said, come to me because I am Sabbath. I am the Sabbath. You get this? Because people will come now over Easter, and they will tell you that Easter is a pagan worship and whatever else, which, yes, most probably some of the stuff, I mean, really, a bunny laying an egg. Obviously, that is Greek mythology. Voila, hello. True. But that's not what it's about. Teach your child the right thing. Jesus, cross. Whether it was now really this weekend or another weekend, it doesn't matter. At least we do have a weekend. And if you really want to go so bad into this is from the devil, Christmas is from the devil, the Easter is from the devil, then why on this world are you still having a weekend? Because the same man that instigated Christmas Day, the same man that instigated Easter, is the same man that initiated the weekend. Why? Because Christians on a Sabbath, on a Saturday, the early church would go to the synagogue. What? I thought they're Christians. Yes, because everybody was at the synagogue, and everybody was still under the law. So what did they do at the synagogue? They went there to evangelize. They went there on a Saturday. They said, we are going to the Sabbath because everybody's at the, and we're going to go to the temple because everybody's at the temple. So everybody was at the temple. That's why Peter, when he passed, the guy was sitting at the gate of the temple. And he said, money and silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have, the power of the Holy Spirit, come on, let's stand up, rise. He was healed. Why? Because they were at the temple on the Sabbath. To do what? To reach people. People that are still in the shadow, who needs to be born again. So their Saturday was an active Christian day to reach out to their world. What do we do as Christians on a Saturday? Raai 'n bietjie en ons gaan ry boot en ons doen dit en ons lê en slaap laat en alles. Maar moet tog net nie vir my vra om iemand na Jesus toe te lei op 'n Saterdag of te nooi kerk toe. However, it was initiated for that purpose. And then Sunday, they had the first day of the week, which as Christians, as a Christian nation, what did they do? They gave us the Sunday so that all Christians can go celebrate the first day of the week with all the hundreds of people that God saved during the week and Saturday, so that we can bring them into the house of God, so that we can celebrate that they gave their lives to Jesus in order for us to continue. The cross changed everything. In the Jewish calendar, you would only have Friday, sundown, till Saturday, sundown. That's it. Then you work like a normal week. It was the Christians that said, okay, let's honor the Sabbath by us going out to the temple, reaching people, telling them about Jesus Christ. Let's have an active day of going out the Sabbath to work to bring in the harvest. And then on a Sunday, we get together the first day of the week because we bring the first fruit of all our increase, the first fruit of the harvest we bring into the house of God. I need to explain these things to you because you'll have Christians talking to your people, calling themselves Christians, and they'll get you back under the law. And then suddenly you've got to be on the Sabbath day. And then suddenly you've got to have this feast and that feast, and you shouldn't do this and shouldn't do this, and you must and you must and you shouldn't, and thou shalt, and the cross is dead. Are you learning something? Because I need to help people with this thing. Otherwise, you get into this thing again, and now, because the natural thing for a Christian is to try to go back to the law, because it feels that I deserve punishment. If I was naughty, I need to get a smack on my bum. So we run in religion, because on Sunday we sit and we hear the Ten Commandments. Ten funny basement. 10 shots, bam, 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 paksla, all the way. After the 10, you walk out again, now you feel like, well, I've deserved it. I'm a little worm, I'm no good. At least I got my punishment for the week, so at least I can carry on again, and here we go again. And then you are no better than what the Israelites was in the Old Testament. But when Jesus comes into your life, the cross changes everything. It changes your life. Why? Because now I don't need to try to be righteous. I am righteous. You see, when sin entered, man was turned upside down. Because you are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. You are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. So when sin came, your spirit was detached from God. What happens? You started living through what you experience, flesh. And you started to reason about what you feel. Now, as a person who has not been redeemed by Jesus Christ, and some people have been redeemed but they don't get it, they still live according to what feels right. I don't feel like going to church. That's why you don't come to church, because I don't go to church because I feel like it. I go to church because that's Jesus' day. But I don't feel like it. I don't feel like praying. I don't feel. So, well, the pastor's word does not stimulate me intellectually, so I'm not going to sit there. I'm going to sleep. But you miss the spirit because your spirit is dead and dormant. So what happens is now, instead of being spirit, soul, body, now you are body, soul, spirit. So everything in this world is designed for the body. Make the body look good, make the body feel great, make the body, everything is about the body. Go check it out, man. Your clothes is for the body, the car is for the body, the house is for the body, the makeup is for the body, the shoes is for the body, the gym is for the body, everything is for the body. And then we realize, okay, people need some balance here in their soulish dimension, so we create some soulish entertainment. But when it comes to spiritual stuff, people look at you, well, if you want to be religious, that's up to you. But we're going to party. When Jesus comes into your life, suddenly he restores, because now he awakens the spirit within you. He breathes on you again. You receive the Holy Spirit. He makes you alive again, and he turns you upside, right side up. And he puts it spirit, soul, body. So now suddenly your body doesn't like it, because your body wants to fight with your spirit. So what is your biggest battlefield in your mind? I want to, but I don't. I feel like it, but I shouldn't. I feel like I should, but I. And now you are in this war again. And the only way that you know how to discipline your flesh is by jumping back into law. Now you're in law. Because the law will teach your flesh. But that's not the truth. Because the law will awaken the desires of the flesh even more. Are you with me? Because the more I tell you you shouldn't, the more you want to. The more I tell you you don't go there, the more you want to. The more I say don't touch that, the more you want to touch it. The more there is something that tells you you shouldn't, you want to. Why? Because the desire of the flesh is so strong now that the desire of the spirit is waging war, and the confusion is in your mind. And that's why most people end up being depressed. Because the war up here is so big that they don't understand that the power in the spirit is stronger, and you don't need war here, you must just submit. So Jesus changes it all. The cross of Jesus Christ, number one, fulfilled the law. Number two, the cross of Jesus Christ restored the kingdom of God. it restored you. Spirit connected with God, living in a soul, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind according to the word, so that you can think the word, I have the mind of Christ, I think the thoughts that Christ thinks, my mind, in the spirit of the mind be renewed. The Bible tells us all these things, it's all scriptures I'm quoting, so that you, in your spirit of your mind, will line up with the things of the spirit, out of your spirit. So when your mind and your spirit lines up, then the flesh would have to submit. That's why we fast and we pray. Not because we want to have a hunger strike and twist God's arm to get us what we want. Here, as jy nou nie vir my gee nie, dan gaan ek nou nie weer verder eet. As if God is now going to respond to you threatening him. No. I can say, bless you, darling heart. He's not going to get upset with you and he's not going to be manipulated by you. He's just going to say, well, whatever. If you want to die of hunger, then die of hunger. I'm not going to try to be strong on you, because if I strong on you, I splat you. It's because you're so small. But I just want to love you. I want you to just submit by yourself and not having to fight this thing. Manipulation is not going to get God anywhere. Are you with me? So he restores you so that you are spirit-led, not flesh-led. Your spirit, your flesh submits by fasting. Why? Because now your whole flesh says, I want to eat, I want to eat. And your spirit says, no, you're going to pray. So that your flesh can learn that you do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from God. That your flesh learns, I don't need this. I don't need what I think I need. I can get along very well without the TV. I can get along very well without the car. I can get along very well without a house. I can get along very well without these things. Because all I need is just to be spirit-led. And it's not that God don't want you to have the house and the cars and the stuff. He wants you to have the stuff. He says, do not seek after it, but seek after the kingdom. Because if you seek the spiritual things, then out of the spiritual things, God will bless you in the physical things. But when we run Christianity after what I can get out of this thing, I come to church because, wat kan die kerk vir my gee? What can the church give me? Man, if I hear that and people tell me, well, I go to the church and it's like that. It's like, did you come to church for what you can get, or did you come to church for what you can contribute? Because just that will tell me what your revelation of the cross is. If you come to church for what you can get, then it's most probably the pastor telling you, oh, you're so good, let me give you a pat on your back. Oh, we're so proud of you, hallelujah, man. I'm so glad you are here. You can go sin for the rest of the week because you've been in church on Sunday, hallelujah. Really, people do that. But what they don't know is I look in these bright lights, so I don't even see half of you. My wife tells me, listen, this person's been in church. Really? Well, that one wasn't in church. I didn't notice. Because I'm here to do a job, to build people. Those who want to be built. To get a revelation to people who want the revelation. I'm over those days where I like, okay, that one was there or not. If my leaders don't do their job, then obviously it's very bad. Because the leaders are the ones that are supposed to know if you're not here. Because they need to come and visit and pray with you. But as the pastor, it is my job, it's my work to get the word, to finish the word in such a way that I in 20 minutes or 40 minutes can give you everything I can in 40 minutes. So it becomes a skill to be able to put a lifetime of revelation into 40 minutes. Because that's it. It doesn't mean the pastor doesn't visit you, come to you. I do. I do. Are you with me? But I'm just telling you how difficult things can get, because if I'm working towards righteousness, I want to be righteous, then I want to show my face. See me, see me, see me, see me. But when it's not about that anymore, when I understand that I love Jesus, Jesus is my righteousness, I am the righteous, then I don't care who's sitting next to me. I love everybody. I don't care who's sitting in the front row and who's sitting in the back row. All I care is about the love of Jesus Christ, the righteousness of God. Because I start to treat you not according to what you try to act to be. I start to treat you according to what God wants you to be. I hope this gets somewhere. I know I'm battling a concept here where some of your minds went tilt. So God comes and he restores the kingdom. Number three, the cross changes our works towards righteousness from righteousness. So now I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I don't have to be justified. I am justified, just as if I never sinned. I walk upright with a good open relationship with God. Even though sometimes sins still come in, I don't give attention to sin. I give attention to God. Because instead of telling my sin about God, or God about my sin, I will rather tell my sin about God. Because where's my focus? My focus is the one that I'm telling it to. God, I have sinned. But you are faithful. You are just to forgive those who come and confess. You are my Savior. You are my Lord. You give me the ability to repent. You are the one that is strong on my behalf. You said you will show you're strong. And I look at God. But if I keep on looking at my sin and feeling guilty and shame about my sin, I kind of doubt God the whole time. And I end up just in the bad place. It's because I want to justify myself by trying to do something to prove to God that I'm good enough. Trying to show the pastor I'm at church so he must be happy with me. I'm not impressed with that because God is not impressed with it. But if you're not here, I will worry and I will pray and I will say, oh, please God, just give them a revelation of what the cross is. Because I don't want to go call them and ask them why they haven't been in church. Because then you get like naughty children. They throw their tantrum because they want to have attention so that somebody come and visit them. Meantime, the door is open the whole time. You might just as well just get in your car, drive to my office, get into my office and say, Pastor, can I see you for 5 minutes? Yes, please. Okay, let's talk about it. What's the problem? Thank you. Okay, great. God bless you. Let's pray for you. And then with the gears, hell, tantrum, gooi, hieronder, and then get all the leaders upset. And all the leaders run to Pastor. Pastor, woo-hoo-hoo. And then the pastor have to run after you. Vaas jy, hoekom kry ek in die hande nie? Jy blok my op Facebook, jy blok my op WhatsApp. Hoe moet ek jou nou in die hande kry? As jy dan nou regtig wil hê, ek moet jou in die hande kry. And get to your house, you lock the gate. Tantrums. Hallelujah. It will not get you anywhere. Because next year it's the same tantrum. And the next year, the same tantrum. And the next year, the same tantrum. Then I'm like, when are you going to grow up? You know where the office is. You know where the door is. You know who my PA. Just ask. God is the same way. Just come to me. Don't throw a tantrum now. Get the whole world upset because of your little thing. Just come to me. Come to me. And I will give you rest. I will give you peace. I will touch you. You don't need to upset the whole village just because something happened. Just come to me. Amen. Are you with me? The last thing, and then I quickly want to wrap it up. Number four. The cross changes things, and there are certain principles before the cross and after the cross. I quickly want to run through this. Certain things, when it comes to the cross, it changes. Certain things, when it comes to the cross, it stops. And certain things, when it comes to the cross, instead of changing or stopping, it increases. Okay? So, I quickly want to run through this. These are principles, simple principles. One of the few, and I'm not mentioning all of them, I'm just naming a few so that you can get the idea. The cross changes everything. Now, Genesis chapter 8, verse 22, the Bible says, seed time and harvest while the earth remains. Seed time and harvest. Cold and heat, summer and winter. And day and night shall not cease. So it's a simple thing of, before the cross, there was a day and there was a night. After the cross, there's a day and a night. Hallelujah. What do you learn in church? Amazing. Before the cross, there was summer and winter. After the cross, there is summer and winter. But now, listen to this one. Before the cross, there was seed time and harvest. After the cross, there's still seed time and harvest. But some people think, well, Jesus has fulfilled it all, so I don't need to sow. Really? Now you need to still sow because that principle doesn't change. It's still the same. Because if I go now to the field and I plant millets, what's going to grow? Millets. So the principle never changed. So whatever I sow with my mouth will still produce a harvest. It's not been fulfilled in Christ now I don't get a harvest. But I just get a good harvest. This is how Christians just complicate things. It's so simple, but yet we make it so complicated. Sow and you will reap. Sow and you will reap. So and you will reap. Before the cross, after the cross, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. It is a principle. This world runs by that principle. As long as you are in the earth, as long as the earth remains, there will be seed time and harvest. Amen? That's why the Bible also tells us in Galatians chapter 4. That's, I read the brief before the cross, now I read after the cross. However, since you have... Galatians 6 verse 7 says, do not be deceived, God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sow, that he shall also reap. If you do, there you have it. He doesn't change. Now, let's look at something else. Certain things stop with the cross. Okay? Like, for instance, the celebration of feasts. I said this earlier. Galatians says, now, however, since you have come to know the true God through personal experience, or rather, to be made known by God, how is it that you are turning back again to the weak and the worthless elemental principles of religions and philosophies to which you have been enslaved all over again? For example, you observe particular days and months and seasons and years. I fear for you that perhaps I have labored to the point of exhaustion over you in vain. Believers, I beg you, become as I am, free from bondage and free from Jewish ritualisms and ordinances. There it is. So the feasts stopped with the cross, because the feasts was fulfilled in the cross. Are you with me? So Pastor, why do we have Christmas and why do we have... Because we are celebrating a day, like a birthday, a remembrance to remind us all, Jesus died for us. Jesus was born. We just do it. It's not Jesus was born on the 25th of December, now everybody shall have his birthday. It's not like that. It's just the day that we say, well, we remember there was a day that Jesus was born, whether it's now the 25th or not, it doesn't matter. The fact is, let's have Christmas. Let's, the love that Jesus had for us, let's show it to the whole world and love one another. Let's give gift, because he came and gave the ultimate gift. That is the principle. It's a principle. It's not a feast that we have to. So if you want to have Christmas or not, it doesn't matter. Really? Because it becomes religion all over again. Same thing with Easter. We remember that Jesus died for us. We remember. But that's why I said, if you have a revelation of the cross, you will not miss one Sunday. Because now we just run for Christmas and we just run for Easter and we just... But we can come together as the believers did in the early church every Sunday and give the whole Sunday unto Jesus and celebrate him. Hallelujah. Are you with me? So there's one of the examples. The feast stopped. Okay, let's quickly run to the next one. My time is up. Certain things increase. For instance, certain things with the cross increase. What happened before the cross? The Sabbath was one day, the seventh day. But with the cross, it changed.
Wow.
Yes, it did. It didn't stop. It didn't stay the same. It changed. Because Jesus came and he said, come to me, whoever are heavy laden and burdened, because I will give you rest. That word rest, because I am Sabbath. If you come to me, you will experience rest. You will experience Sabbath. Because I am the Sabbath. If you come to me, you will experience Sabbath. So how many times a week do you go to Jesus? Wow, every day. So the Sabbath is every day. It's not just one day anymore. Every day is Sabbath. Every day is in the presence of God. Every day is with Jesus. So when I start my day, I start with the first food, the first hour, and then I give my whole day to Jesus. And whenever during the day I get tired, I don't just go and sleep to get the flesh gratification. No, I put up a worship song and I get into the presence of God, and suddenly everything changes. And his spirit comes, and there is fullness of joy in his presence. And he rejuvenates me when I get into his presence. Because he's Sabbath. He gives me rest. Otherwise, we all have to work, and then on the seventh day, then we all sleep. And then get up after that seventh day, and you're still not rested, and you start running again. Because in our busy world, you don't rest on one day. So have rest every day with Christ. That is where the Sabbath changed. It became every day. Another thing that changed, because people have a huge issue with this thing, tithing. Tithing is an issue. Because suddenly, some people will tell you, tithing is of the Old Testament. Well, tithing was there before the law. It was a principle. And I want to prove to you that tithing is not just for the Old Testament. And it's not just something for the New Testament. It actually increased. Because tithing is for the Old Testament. When Abraham came and he set the example, he says, for me, I will give 10% of all my increase. I will give it to God. And God blessed him for it. And then it came under the law when God said, you have robbed me with tithing and offering. Why do you rob me with your tithes? Okay? So God speaks to them. Jesus comes in the New Testament in Matthew 23:23. He says, you should not stop tithing. And then Jesus dies and something happens. Instead of the early church just bringing the tithes to their storehouse, something happens in the book of Acts chapter 2. They came and they became one with the house of God. And they gave everything. They sold houses. They sold farms. They sold land. They sold everything. And they gave it all. So that everybody had equal. Amen. Hebrews chapter 7 talks about it. When we present it all to Christ. So when CRC comes and we say, at least honor the Lord with the tithe. It worked in the Old Testament and God will bless your tithe. But actually, my brother, it all belongs to God. Everything. That's why my cars is not mine. My house is not mine. Everything belongs to the church. It's God's. If I walk out of this church tomorrow, if I get up and I walk out of this church, I walk out here with the clothes on my back and that's it. There is that. Because it's not mine. It's his. And I'm not saying I'm better than anybody else. I'm just telling you how we as CRC pastors live our lives. When I resign, I leave it all. I said, I can make two kinderkies and my vrou kie met die klere op ons rug en ons loop. And a surprise for you, I'll most probably walk alone. Because my wife is very clear with that. We are very clear with that. If you leave this church, I'm sorry, I'm done with you as well. It's a commitment we made when we joined this vision. Why? Because it's not because it's just CRC. This is where our life started. This is where my life started. This is where my life changed. This is where her life changed. This is where she met Jesus. This is where we got married. This is where we met one another. So how can anything be blessed without it? It's a shocker. Boom. Here's the shock. So when the pastor comes and he says, at least give a tithe, really, just smile and give your tithe. Don't make an issue of it. Because really, if you want to read the Bible, then I can stand here and say, okay, waar is hy huis, waar is hy kar, waar is hy goed, kom. Ons wil grond koop, ons wil 'n kerk bou, waar is dit? Kom. And then you will see how upset people get. They already get so upset about 10%. How are they going to get upset when you say, bring it all? That's why when it comes to these things, we ask you, whatever is in your heart to give. At least the tithe, my friend, at least, it was a principle in the Old Testament, you will be blessed with it, at least. So come on, at least. But for the rest, according to the generosity in your heart. Amen. I hope you learned something this day. Come on, let's all stand. Father, I glorify you. I honor you. Thank you for this word. Thank you for teaching us. Thank you for leading us. Thank you for giving us line upon line, precept upon precept. Thank you, Jesus, for changing our lives. Holy Spirit, I pray that this word will not just be logos, but it will become a rhema on the inside. That we will start to live this, Lord. That this will become such a thrill to live, Lord. That we will not try to earn righteousness, but we walk in righteousness. Because you have made us righteous. You have given us righteousness. And I thank you, Jesus, for your touch today. I pray, Holy Spirit, those who do not know you, that they will turn today and come to you. Now, while every head is bowed, every eye closed, maybe you are standing here today and you say to me, Pastor, I've never come to a place where I actually gave my life to Jesus. I don't remember a day and a time. And it bothers me now because I realize I'm most probably just trying to be a good man, a good behavior. Behaving well so that I can be acceptable by God. But if I have to tell you the honest truth, is my heart is far from God. I don't even know Jesus. I don't know him. I really don't. Well, then I want to ask you today, make up your mind and get to know him. He has died for you on the cross. He has given you everything. God has made the first step. Now all he wants is you to respond. Because you can't save yourself. It doesn't matter what you do. You cannot save yourself. It's only Jesus that died for you. Only Jesus can save you. That's why I want to ask you right now, if that's you and you're standing here, you're sitting and you say, Pastor, I need to give my life to Jesus. I need to surrender my life to Jesus because I realize I will not be able to save myself ever. I cannot be good enough. Then this message is for you, my friend, so that you can realize that Jesus loved you so much. He came to this world. He paid the price of sin so that you can be saved. He loves you. He loves you dearly. He loves you so much. So I want to ask you right now, if that is you and you say, Pastor, I want to give my life to Jesus. Maybe you say, I want to come back to Jesus. I once did follow him, but I walked away. And I realize today how important it is to love Jesus first. Then I want to include you in that prayer as well. So if you're one of those people, you say, I want to give my life to Jesus or I want to come back to Jesus. Then quickly, wherever you are, quickly just slip up your hand. Put it up high. Forget about the person next to you. This is between you and Jesus. Thank you. Come on, just put it up high, high, high. Give your life to Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. In the other locations, please, if that is you, you need to give your life to Jesus. You want to give your life to Jesus. Quickly, just where you are, lift up your hand right now. There. Thank you. Thank you. All over this place. You're still battling in your mind. Please don't wait for a better day. Today is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day of salvation. Respond to Jesus. Respond to him right now. One last time, you haven't raised your hand and you still want to be included in that prayer. Quickly, wherever you are, just slip it up right now. Put it up. Put it up. Put it up. Put it up. Thank you. Once you raise your hand, you can put it down. Everybody, please look at me. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, I would like to invite you to come to the front. It's at the altar where we do everything. We lay down our lives. It's at the altar where we get dedicated. It's the altar where we get married. It's the altar where your body will be one day when you die, when we bury you. But it's at this altar where the most important thing happens, and that is where people meet at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ, where the cross changes everything in your life. So I want to ask you, if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, that you would please, for a moment, just leave your seat, take your personal belongings, and just come to the front. And family, listen, while people will be coming and we are going to clap for them, I want to ask you, please, just turn to three or four people around you and ask them, look them in the eye and ask them, are you sure you're okay? Can I walk with you? And please, if they come, walk with them. You can stand with them. You can go afterwards. You can go back. But if you bring somebody, stand with them. Please, let's do that. So all over this place, if that's you, you want to give your life to Jesus, you want to come back to Jesus, then right now, take your personal belongings, leave your seat, come to the front as we sing. Come on, let's sing. Come on, there's many more of you. Come on, come on, come on, come to Jesus.
Come,
oh, come on, come to Jesus.
God.
Come to Jesus.
Oh, your sins are forgotten.
Come to Jesus. Listen, I feel it strong in my heart. There's still people. There's still people. Come on, just turn to a person. Look at them again. And be honest. Don't be making it a fun thing and smiley, smiley. Be honest now. Look at one another. Look them in the eyes and ask them, hey, is he okay? Are you sure? Are you sure? Can I walk with you? Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Just play the music, please. But please, just do that now. Because I feel there are a stirring in my heart. That there are people still standing. And they know. They know, and it's just that little bit. I saw people standing in this church, how they would fight. Because lips. It's like the flesh stops them from coming, but it's like their spirit yearns. So just come on. Just respond to Jesus. Don't fight it. Don't fight it. Jesus doesn't need to fight you. So come on, all over this place. Just look at somebody quickly, quickly, quickly. Come on, come on. Around you. Come on. Look at them. Look at them. Ask them. Hey, is you okay? Can I look some of your stuff? Come on. I know it feels awkward, but this is love. This is our way of reaching our world. Being honest and truthful. Come on. Somebody still needs to come. Come with them. Come with them. Come on, let's sing. Let's sing. Let's sing. Let's sing. With me, just put your hand on your heart. I'm so glad that each one of you came to the front, because if it was for one person, it's worth it. People sometimes ask me, really, would Jesus die for one person? Yes, he would. Without a shadow of a doubt, he would. Because that's how his passion for people. He's not just there for the crowds, he's there for the individual. The individual. So pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I surrender myself to you. I realize that I cannot live this life without you. I need you. Please help me. Thank you for saving me. I accept your forgiveness. And I ask you, Holy Spirit, help me to become exactly what you need me to be. I will follow. And I will love you. Help me to do that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Now we want to spend 5 minutes with you just to quickly give you a little booklet and just pray with you individually. So will you please just turn to your left, my right, just follow the people over there. We're not going to do anything funny. We just want to pray for you. Come on. Come on, let's give them a hand as they go. Come on, oh people, we are excited about people giving their life to Jesus. Give them a shout. Amen. You can take your seat for a moment. If we lose our passion to get souls saved, then we have lost our passion for living. Let's never lose our passion for people and for getting people saved. Let's never lose our fire to invite people to the house of God. Because this is where it all changes. Right here. This is where it all changes. Right here. Right here. Amen. Come on, this is where you changed. So let's get other people changed as well. Amen. We're going to take up the offering this morning. I read to you earlier that we give unto the Lord the first fruit of all our increase. Okay? The first fruit of all our increase. So let's quickly turn to the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 to 10, the Bible says, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruit of all your income. This is in the Amplified Bible. Then your barns will be abundantly filled, and your vats will overflow with new wine. There's a principle that the Bible talks about. It's the word honor. There's a big difference between respect and honor. Respect never costs you anything. That's why respect should be given to all. Okay? Because it doesn't cost you. It's just good manners to respect the person. So many people have respect, but when it comes to honor,